Continuing on my sort of semi-spree of playing games that are based on cartoons, I've decided to revisit one of the games that had truly challenged me as a child, Tailspin on the NES. I used to rent it from a place called Video Systems too often. I don't know why, as it really used to kick my rear end. But I was determined to get better at it, although I never really did. But I still had fun, and that's truly the mark of a good game, right? In Tailspin, you play as the big, lovable bear called Baloo, as he attempts to deliver quote-unquote cargo to 8 random locations, while attempting to avoid Don Carnage and his merry band of ace pilots. Honestly, that's about all I remember from Tailspin in general, as I was never really fond of the cartoon. I was more of a Darkwing Duck guy. However, I used to read the Tailspin comics included in the old Disney Adventure Kids mags, but that's because I'm a nerd and enjoy reading pretty much anything. So yeah, Tailspin is a horizontal shooter, also known by many as a shmup. Baloo starts with 3 hit units of health, a slow plane, and the ability to fire one shot at a time, as he's immediately attacked by enemies. His goal is simply to try to collect the money bags, cargo, and, for some weird reason, fruit, and get to the end of the stage, defeat the boss, and collect your pay. Straightforward, right? Well, as you can probably tell by the slow plane and one shot at a time comment I mentioned mere seconds ago, this game, right from the start, begins on a bit of a rough note. Let's face it, limiting your shots to a sole bullet against 3 enemies at a time is a really dumb design choice. It honestly makes the first stage of the game possibly one of the hardest ones included in the game, and it could potentially turn off any potential long-term players. But that's where that cargo and money bags come in handy. Once you clear a boss and you get paid, those items that you grabbed on your way to your destination act as a bonus, giving you some more much-needed cash. After every stage, you move on to the shop with the mechanic character, who I can't remember the name to, and he gives you 6 upgrade options, 2 of which, the continue and the extra life, can be purchased multiple times, although the price does increase each time you choose it. The other 4 upgrades are much, much more important. One increases your life meter by 1 unit, which may not sound like a lot, but you'd be surprised how that one extra hit could really get you through some hazardous zones. Another upgrade increases the speed of the plane, which is really handy for the third stage boss. The other 2 upgrades allow you to increase the amount of the shots you can fire at a time, with one being just 1 extra shot, while the other, more expensive one, will give you, I think, 4 shots at a time. Personally, the order that I preferred was the single shot upgrade, the speed, then armor, and then the best shot upgrade. I then just bought continues and extra lives after that. These upgrades are not cheap, so you may want to plot out how to make your life a bit easier when attempting later stages. One thing that is kind of weird and takes getting used to is the ability to shoot behind you. In order to do this, you simply press A. This flips your plane around, and not only does this allow you to fire backwards, it also makes the screen move in the opposite direction. It's a neat thing once you get the hang of it. I do need to note, though, that the controls overall are kind of stiff. There are plenty of times I had to press A a few times in order to flip around, and this got me damaged or even killed a few times. There's also the threat of being crushed between the screen edge and an obstacle. Extra lives are thankfully pretty plentiful. Not only can you find them hidden through each stage by shooting random areas, you can also enter bonus areas by, well, shooting random areas. Entering these areas allow you to play as the young Kit on a special flying thingy, and he flies around, popping balloons, and collecting the fruit and occasional extra lives that are found within. There's only 2 or 3 different types of these bonus areas, so if you know which one you've entered, and you've memorized each one, you can easily grab the extra lives as they don't change positions. And amazingly, you can collect more than 9 lives in this game. It's stupid, I know, but it's surprisingly rare when games allow you to get more than a single digit, even if there is a 0 preceding that number. And yes, although the game gets a bit easier once you accumulate some extra lives and buy upgrades, it's still not exactly a simple game. As a kid, I was never able to beat the construction stage, and even now, I'm pretty sure I beat that boss by complete accident. I don't think I knew back then that you had to destroy the wrecking ball first to have even a chance, but once I figured that out, I was able to eventually defeat it, and so this was the first time I've ever gotten this far. And, well, I was able to easily complete the game after this. Sure, the final stage was a bit tricky, but it's mostly just a boss battle, and the other 2 stages, the cave and the jungle, weren't really that bad. I mean, the boss in the cave was disappointingly easy, and the jungle boss wasn't much worse. Do the upgrades help? Of course. And this is why I stand by the fact that the earlier stages are much harder than the later ones. Just like every other Capcom-published Disney game, the sound design is great. The music has some catchy themes, although I will admit that the sounds often cut off instruments. That was one thing Capcom was guilty of a lot, and I'm not sure if it was them or the NES's limitations. Either way, if you've played other mid-to-late NES life Capcom games, you'll know what to expect with the audio. The same can be said with the graphics. The game is bright and colorful, with some fantastic detail applied to Baloo, the Sea Duck, and the enemies. There's some cool storm effects in the third stage, and some of the bosses are fairly large, taking up the entire screen. I especially love the Invisible Man and the Evil Baseball. They may not be too difficult, but they were still fun to battle. And that's Tailspin. Don't let the first stage deter you from playing the game. It's an enjoyable experience that, although having moments of controller-breaking frustration, isn't too hard if you stick with it. Playing it for this review was the first time I've ever been able to complete the game, and it felt good after 20 plus years to finally add it to my completed list, and considering how bad I normally am at these styles of games, it felt even better. If you don't have an NES laying around or dabble in emulation, you can get it for modern consoles on the Disney Afternoon Collection, along with Darkwing Duck, DuckTales, and Rescue Rangers. Rescue Rangers? Now, that's another game I need to get around to playing again. Final score? 5 out of 7. This is Reaper. Happy fragging.